Welcome back, everyone. It is time for a podcast to buy it. We are the line of scrimmage between Michigan and Michigan State fans here on social media. I'm Don Thomas. It's my partner, Connor Muldowney. And we're not doing so good right now.
We're sad. We're sad. Football's dead to us, I think.
Yeah, it's basketball season coming up soon. So, and then starting next week, we actually got basketball people coming on. So, give us something to look forward to in our little bubble. So, but we got football. We got beat by a combined 38 plus 24. We got beat by a combined 62 points this week and scored a combined 11 points. So, yeah, just not good, man. Just where does Sparty go from here, man? 24-0 Indiana. Where do y'all go from here?
You got to figure out the quarterback situation. You know, Peyton Thorne looked fine when he was in there for Rocky. Rocky's just not the guy. I think he threw 7 passes and 2 of them were really bad interceptions. Defense actually, that's the one thing I will say about this team. The defense is actually looking like a Michigan State defense should. First half, they didn't play great. Second half, they kind of buckled down. Obviously, Indiana probably took their foot off the gas. Defense looks like it might be the bright spot of this team, which I think before the season it was talked about that like this was a slightly before the no-fly zone era defense that we could be seeing. That's what the coaching staff was saying. So like maybe this is something to build on. Maybe next year it becomes more of like a dominant defense or closer to that, and like 2 years from now it's 2013 type of defense. But they have good building blocks. Offense has a lot of question marks. You can't score 7 points in 8 quarters and win anything or even be competitive in anything. And that's what it's been since the Michigan win. The offense just has to figure something out. Jay Johnson has questions to answer. And there's a lot of work to be done.
Yeah, I agree. Main thing is defense is playing well. That's a bright spot. You play well enough in one of these games coming up and keep the team within striking distance, who knows what can happen. So that's a good thing. And I think finding the quarterback, finding someone that can get you through, put you in the best position to win and also get experience, that's number one right now. Like I've been saying the whole year, Mel Tucker's in – this is year zero. Mm-hmm. This is not year one. This is year zero. So it's just kind of figuring out what you got and getting guys some live reps. And as a bonus, shoot, you got Paul as a bonus.
Yeah.
So that's
– yeah, don't care. We got Paul. That's our motto this year.
If you're a Sparty fan, you can't be able to stick. If you're a Michigan fan, you're just kind of scratching your head. And that's
really what's going on over there. What's going on in Ann Arbor?
Oh, man. It's literally the perfect storm, like that movie. Literally everything that can go wrong is going wrong. Don Brown, his defensive system, I do believe he's a good defensive coordinator. I think he knows how to coach. But the issue is he's stubborn. And he only knows one way, which is pressure. But the problem is there is no pressure. There's no pressure, and the cornerbacks aren't able to play on islands right now. The defense isn't very disciplined, the defense isn't flowing. The run fits aren't good. It's a mess. Offensively, the talent is there. It's just the scheme right now is not putting Joe Milton in the best position to succeed. Michigan has 2 running backs, Hassan Haskins and Zach Charbonnet, that I think they're like 6 or 7 yards a carry each, and they're not getting enough touches. You have to pound it. You have to force feed it. Get these guys ready. Get some guys that can go downhill, and then bring guys like Chris Evans and Blake Corum, who are more of the shifty guys, and bring them kind of as a supplement. And I just think it's just out of order right now, and it's killing Joe Milton's confidence. It's going to be interesting to see how what happens going into Rutgers, the quarterback situation. I think it's fair to kind of see what you got out of Cade and all that. But Michigan fans blaming Joe Milton, you're blaming the wrong person. It's a systematic issue. And when you have a young team that doesn't have the leadership it needs, playing well, it's just a recipe for disaster. And it's really hard for coaches to really coach guys up, because if they're not motivated and they're not confident, then it's really nothing you can do. And so Rutgers is this weekend. Michigan can very well lose to Rutgers. But at the same time, it's going to come down to what are they going to do? How are they going to respond? How are they going to react? Because even a 3-point win at Rutgers this weekend would do a lot for this team's confidence, because I think that's what this team needs. This team needs leadership. This team needs confidence. And the team needs something good to happen. I think that's going to help out kind of dig out of this 1-3 stretch right now. But yeah.
Did we mention basketball is almost back? Oh yeah, we did. But that's on the mind.
Well, while still football, we got we do have the great Isaiah Hall of USA Today, the Wolverine Wire branch, and then we've got our Pick 10 with our new full time Pick 10 guest, Lucy Rohden, Miss Iowa. So that's going to be a lot of fun. I'm looking forward to that one. So we definitely thank y'all for tuning in again. Once again, this is a podcast divided, a line of scrimmage between Michigan and Michigan State. What's up, everybody? Welcome back. This is a podcast divided. We are the line of scrimmage between Michigan and Michigan State here on social media. I'm Don Thomas. We're talking about the very brutal weekend that we had in the state of Michigan for football. Michigan State didn't score any points, but Michigan might as well not score anything either. So how you feeling, Connor?
It was rough. It was a rough weekend, but, you know, basketball season's right around the corner, so that's pushing me through it.
Yep. Wait till next week, y'all. We got we got basketball next week, so y'all can be really happy, so we can kind of perk up a little bit. But without any further ado, I've got Isaiah Hull. He is from Wolverine Wire of USA Today. He's very connected within the program and has some great takes and great podcasts. And I want to really kind of bring him on for some insight because right now Michigan is really at a crossroads, so to speak. Are they going to salvage the season or is the type of effort and performance that we have right now going to be a thing for the rest of the year, and where should Michigan go from here? How you doing, Isaiah? Welcome to the show.
I'm good. Just, plowing through the Rutgers week, which is normally a down week anyway. It's particularly down after you get blown out 49-11, but, you know, just plowing through. Just can't wait to get to Piscataway. Beautiful New Jersey, as said no one except for local New Jersey people. But, that's where we're at.
You got the turnpike.
Which I hope to not see at all, actually. I don't think I will, actually. I'm taking the train down from Newark Airport down to...
That actually makes sense. That's a smart move from me being up there. But, yeah, speaking of that, Michigan's kind of a mess right now. I mean, not kind of. It's a full-blown mess. Had their worst home loss since 1935, you know, back when our grandparents were just coming into the world. And the worst overall loss since the Gator Bowl when Rich Rodriguez's last game in 2011 against Mississippi State. So it's a rough time. So what's – from being around the program and talking to the players and coaches, kind of what's the overall barometer and how are you feeling about what you're seeing?
I'm a little bit mixed on kind of what I'm seeing because – not saying that I want them to be morose, because I don't think that's really the right move for the people inside the program, right? Like, you can't just sit there and sulk and things aren't going to get any better. Clearly, Jim Harbaugh, after the Wisconsin game, was extremely morose, just looked absolutely just beat up after that game. Came back on Monday and was way more upbeat and was more of the... Like, I asked him, I said, you know, you said you wanted to reevaluate everything in the program. I know you've only had a day and a half, but have you been able to do, what have you been able to do? And he's more like, oh, we're just going to get right back at it. And we're going to, you know, we're back at work today. I couldn't be more fired up to try to get our guys going and stuff like that. Now, you know, the part of me that has to feed information to people wanted to hear more of kind of what we heard back, you know, after the game. But at the same time, you know, if you're trying to get back on the winning side of things, you can't sit there and be down on it. I still would have liked it, right? But at least it seems like as far as trying to get things back on track, he's got the right attitude. It's certainly not playing well with the fans, right? Like, it's just not, and it's not going to, you know, it's just going to continue to until they get back in the win column. And a win against Rutgers, probably just like last year, isn't going to do a heck of a lot for fans. They're going to want to see something more than that. So, you know, you got to string that along, though, with a win against Penn State the following week. The players equally, I mean, I think there's a lot of accountability, which I think is good and it's refreshing for the most part. You still have a little bit of guys, you know, essentially they're certainly not making excuses, but there's certainly an element of we're really close. And I feel like, you know, you don't want to, again, it's the same deal as you don't want them to feel like they're really far away, because honestly, as far away as they look, they aren't nearly as far away as I would say a lot of fans would make them seem like they're at. It's, you know, a lot of the issues are, you know, two things. It's coaching and execution, and neither have been particularly good. If they get on the same page like they were in week one, we're talking about a completely different story. So it's just a matter of them having that belief. So it seems like they do. I think there's a lot of confusion as to why the last three games have gone the way that they have. But again, like we said off air, no off season, no non-conference. They weren't really able to get a tune-up. I know no teams were able to, but Michigan's a really young team. And I think that the fact that they didn't have that, this Rutgers game comes at a perfect time, even though they are much improved. I mean, this isn't a lock for Michigan to win by any means, but it comes at a perfect time because it allows them to essentially hopefully see what it feels like to get back on the winning side of things, whether their technique is good or bad or whatever. So it's just a way, it's a game to not go up against a team that's better than you, and hopefully get a little bit of fire back.
From like an outsider's perspective, like as a Michigan State fan, we saw this kind of, you know, beat upness from the head coaching position last year. You know, when D'Antonio lost to Illinois, there was that defeated look on his face in the press conference. Harbaugh didn't quite have the same look or demeanor, but you could tell he's definitely been going through it. And I mean, how much does that wear on the team, like on the players when they see him, you know, like his job is on the line here too. Does that put extra pressure on them, or do they just keep going, you know, business as usual? Or, you know, you get what I'm saying?
Oh yeah, totally. I think that is actually why they've kind of taken that business as usual approach once the week actually got here, right? You do as Juwan Howard on the basketball side says, and embrace the suck, and you do it for just a, you know, for that weekend, and then you get back to, you know, the coaches were back on Sunday. The players got back to do film things on Monday, back to practice today. So I think you do have to try to put it in the rear view. I'm sure it takes a big toll on the players, you know, with the, you know, right now, I'm sure a lot of them aren't terribly sure that their head coach will be around. If not after, you know, not after this year, after the following year, unless they do something. And the thing that concerns me with that, and it's something that I kind of felt has been happening since somewhat actually kind of late in that Michigan State game, is that guys start trying to press and do too much. Now they swear that they're not doing that. If you ask them that in a press conference, they swear that they're just, you know, everyone's doing their job, but you know, sometimes guys aren't doing their job or whatever. I that's not how I see it. I see guys that are trying to, you know, do all things, be all things. And when you do that, I mean, it tends that bad things are going to happen. You try to play outside of your capability or what your role is. And to me, that was one of the big things that caused Michigan to lose to Ohio State last year, was exactly that. So that still seems to be a symptom of the program. And yeah, I mean, to kind of get to what you're saying, I definitely saw a defeat on Saturday. But it kind of seemed like same old Jim Harbaugh on Monday, like, right. Like you could have dropped me into the middle of last season in the middle of the season, and I would have thought nothing different of it.
I mean, I know Don has seen it, but there's been so many fans jumping off the bandwagon, you know, kind of calling for his job. How much of a pass do you think he gets in this type of year, just because of the situation, Corona, all that kind of stuff? How much of a pass do you think, not just him, but like guys like James Franklin, how much of a pass do you think that their athletic departments give them?
Well, with those two particular programs, I think they get quite a bit of leeway. I don't think James Franklin's going anywhere from Penn State either. And I also don't think that Michigan's going to fire Jim Harbaugh. I don't know where kind of fans have gotten into their heads that's a certainty. I think that it's more likely than not that he's brought back, because yeah, this is a different year. Things are a little bit different. You would have to expect that maybe you ask them to make some changes, you know, whether it be the coaching staff, evaluate why things didn't work in the COVID year, but it worked for some of the other programs around. I mean, you look at Indiana. Indiana picked up right where everyone kind of thought that they would. The people that were like me that thought that Indiana could be a real threat this year. So I think they deserve a pass, because certainly Penn State's not as bad as 0-4 suggests. I mean, they haven't looked good at all. I mean, Will Levis actually looked decent this last week against Nebraska when he finally got his number called. But, things aren't going to be in rhythm in the same way that they normally would be. And I think that additionally, it kind of feels like you're in midseason form. I know technically we are now in midseason, but right now, normally we'd be further down the season. And I think that people's mindsets kind of are as if the seasons had the non-conference, had those warmups, because I said this to Don off air, if Michigan and Penn State had their non-conference, yeah, Michigan certainly could have gone and lost to Washington. But then they would have gotten back in the win column the next 2 weeks against Ball State and Arkansas State. I don't know Penn State's non-conference schedule offhand, but I'm sure that they would have gone into their Big Ten season 2-1 or 3-0 at, 2-1 being the absolute worst that they would have been. And, the struggles probably wouldn't been there as much, because you would have had that tune-up. You would have known what your issues were earlier, because teams like Michigan and Penn State, they didn't have that the benefit essentially. I mean, all these teams have to go through it, but Michigan and Penn State, at this point have major problems. And normally you are able to get to that before you get to the tougher competition, and you're able to address it and try to figure it out. Neither of those teams got that ability. So if I'm the athletic directors, I am giving them a bit of a pass, as much as that might be an anathema to, I can't say that word, but to the fan bases of either. But maybe you reevaluate your coaching staff. You try to figure out what you can fix behind the scenes before you actually sweep them out the door. I think maybe even to that note, you look at South Carolina, they groomed Will Muschamp. In that case, I think it might be because they feel like they can get someone better. I don't think Michigan and Penn State are necessarily in that same boat.
I think Muschamp was a long time coming. I think that should have happened already. So that's definitely, like, Harbaugh and Franklin are on a different page than that, but I get what you're saying. This probably was just like his trial period. Like, you better show something early or you're gone.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. Cause the thing about it is, going into the season, Jim Harbaugh nor James Franklin were on the chopping block. Will Muschamp was living on borrowed time with the way they have been playing. So I think it's false equivalency to say, well, South Carolina fired their guy, why can't we? It's different because, both Penn State and Michigan have had success under those coaches. It's just a weird year.
But there's also higher standards at Penn State and Michigan. So, I mean, you put Harbaugh at South Carolina and have those results, and he's put on a pedestal. There's probably a statue built of him, but what he's done in Michigan is just, it might not quite be good enough. They need those championships.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think the one thing Isaiah, if you agree, you're fine, but one thing I think people are a lot of folks, especially fans, this is the nature of fans, where they want change for the sake of change. Where the backup quarterback is usually unless it's like a Heisman guy, the backup quarterback's usually the favorite player on the team for fans. The backup is definitely the best guy, and we got to put in, man. If we put the backup quarterback in, we're going to win a bunch of games. That's usually not the case. And same thing with coaches. Because I had someone recently on Twitter was like, fire Harbaugh. We bring in anybody, man. I don't care. We bring in just a guy who's not unproven, and he'll cut and shake it all up. Like, guys, we don't – I mean, there changes need to be made, but we don't need to be reinventing the wheel either.
No, and for though there's a lot of people that have kind of on the mindset of it can't get worse, or if it does get worse, then, it can be fixed. I mean, listen, Michigan was wandering through the desert for 7 years, save for 2011, and it can get worse. It can get worse than it was even then, because
– yes.
You look at, other programs around. Look at Tennessee. Tennessee has not even had the success that Jim Harbaugh has brought to Michigan. They have been so irrelevant despite the recruiting and whatever. It's they're in an easier conference, or not conference, but division within their conference. And they still can't seem to get out of the, not the basement. They might be somewhere on the first floor, but they're trying to get to the fifth, and they just kind of finally have crawled out of the basement. It can get so much worse if you go to someone that is not going to necessarily get you to where you need to be. But and that goes on multiple levels too, right? It's not just what happens on the field, because it's, you could face another Rich Rod situation where if they go and hire someone that the boosters or the, you know, people within the administration with university, and if they're not all on the same page, then you could find that situation where they're losing before they even get a chance to step foot on the field.
Yeah.
So and on top of it, you have the Harbaugh rule likely going into effect in January, you know, with 1 year transfers being allowed. You get rid of Harbaugh, you might lose a good chunk of the team who, if they don't instantly decide to stay with a new coach, you could lose half the recruiting class. And for anyone that's like, well, good, these guys aren't good, guess what? That sets your program back a couple of years regardless.
Exactly.
It's just going to. You have to retain the talent you have, even if you don't think they're talented. You know, it's like you mentioned the next man up mentality. I've seen quite a bit of that when it comes to like, well, you know, I don't like how Jamon Green is playing. Put in the next guy. And it's like, as far as we know, the next guy is not nearly as good as Jamon Green, because you're only as good to the coaches of what you're showing in practice.
Exactly.
And people think, well, maybe this guy is way better in games. It usually doesn't work that way. Maybe like what I would imagine, one in a couple thousand players have that, you know, big light ability where suddenly they're making better plays in games than they are practice, but it's highly unlikely. And coaches aren't just sitting there saying like, well, this guy's awesome, but I really like the way that this guy looks. I like that the way the guy wears his jersey. They're not doing that.
No.
So it's just a matter of.
What boggles my mind is how fans believe they know more than the coaches. These coaches have seen thousands of reps in practice, on film, in the games. You can see a kid's high school film, or you see a kid play a couple snaps in garbage time, and you think the coaches don't know. Like, guys, are you serious? And like, this is even with the quarterback situation right now. I think right now, especially with how things are going, I think they're doing the right thing by kind of opening it up and seeing what Kay can do. I think that's fair right about now. Mm-hmm. But the thing about it is, it's not all on Joe.
No.
And then talking about Dylan McCaffrey, like, guys. I've met Dylan before. Dylan is the nicest, most polished young man. Had a great little conversation with him. Cool kid, man. I wish him all the best. But, Dylan got beat out.
Mm.
He got beat out by – and the thing about it is, if he stayed on the team, he'd have been number three. And people don't realize that. Like, you can't get so enamored with a last name that you think that he's better than what's out there right now. If he was as good, if it was neck and neck, he'd still been out there. But you're nice kid, you got beat out. Same thing when I was in college. I got beat out. Hey, it is what it is. When you get to college, it's different. Everyone gets beat out.
Yeah, and that's a big thing. And I mean, Cade looked great in the spot duty he was called to have. Let's not act like Michigan was down one score and he brought him, you know, within your down two scores and brought him with, you know, within tying the game up. Game was 35-11 at that point. Game was out of hand. It was garbage time at that point. Wisconsin had that game in hand, and you're going to take your foot off the gas just a little bit. Think Dylan McCaffrey, actually, last year against Wisconsin, right? Like, Dylan McCaffrey came in, there was an energy, they moved the ball. They ended up scoring that touchdown. Game was already over. It didn't matter. So there's a difference between doing it in crunch time and not doing it in crunch time. Not that Joe's had much of a chance to do it in crunch time, but I mean, Guy has not been the reason why Michigan's lost. There's been plenty of other reasons. I mean, he's had three pretty decent games. He's made some mistakes in the last, the two that before Wisconsin, but they weren't egregious mistakes per se. The Indiana game, at that point, they were within striking distance and they were asking to force the ball downfield. One of the interceptions was on him. One of them wasn't.
Yeah.
It's a little bit different when you're facing a, you know, a 21-28 spot like Michigan was, and or 35-3 actually, you know, like when Cade came in. I should correct myself on that. He got Michigan to 11, but that game was done. And it's different when a guy is making, is able to get 300 yards a game with no running game, like Joe was able to do for two straight games. And in another guy coming in and completing four passes. I mean, it's just, it's not, it's a false equivalency essentially.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I know all about quarterback issues.
Yeah, man. Peyton Thorne, he ran that that first carry, looked really good. I didn't pay much attention to that game, but I watched a couple minutes of it, and I saw him come in, and I thought, oh, suddenly Michigan State's got a spark.
Yeah, I mean, I think everybody kind of realizes that Rocky's not the long term answer, and he had the good game against Michigan where he took advantage of the secondary. And he had the good-ish game against Rutgers, but he still threw, I think, two interceptions. Peyton Thorne has got – I mean, he has to be the guy moving forward. And like you were saying, you know, fans always think that they know best, but I think in this situation, like, Rocky Lombardi is skipping 10-yard passes to receivers at this point. And if he's not healthy, which he might not be, who knows? He says he's healthy, but if you're skipping passes, you know, 2 yards short on a 10-yard route, that you're not the guy. I mean – He tried a couple long passes against Indiana, and they just were ducks. So I think that his good fortune ran out.
Well, there's a difference between between Joe and Rocky in that sense, right? Because Joe hasn't looked bad until this last game when things just really weren't going good for him at all. He didn't look good again. I just want to reiterate that. It's not that he looked good against Michigan State or Indiana, but he didn't look bad. Mm-hmm. Rocky has had one decent game. I won't even say great game because mm-hmm. he was what, a 52% passer against Michigan, was really struggling again on the intermediate passes, but just managed to just nail every yeah. And that's just not, you know, you're not going to be able to keep that up.
It's not sustainable at all. And I think that the staff should have realized that earlier. I think I was calling for that. They kept him in for three full quarters of the Iowa game, and it was like 42-7. And I was like, he can't hit receivers on the run. He can't hit them standing still. Like, it's time to make a change. If the backups are worse than this, then you might as well put a running back there and just run the ball all the time. But they can't run the ball either, so that doesn't – yeah, the Wildcat. We can't run either, so it's just a lose-lose.
Well, sometimes then this is one of those things too, and I said this on my podcast earlier today, where you might want to just get, you know, like, I don't know Michigan State's situation behind closed doors, but you know, they might've been like, all right, Peyton Thorne or Theo Day or, you know, whoever else is behind Rocky, they might not feel like he's ready where they can trust him to go out. But so they're like, let's ride Rocky until we, you know, can't anymore.
Yeah.
Because you also don't want to just trot out a guy. You don't want to trot out Peyton Thorne and have his confidence completely ruined in game one. Mm-hmm. That, you know, we've seen here in Ann Arbor, we've seen quarterbacks with PTSD. I'm good friends with Devin Gardner. Dude had no line and he had PTSD beyond his first couple games. So you have to make sure that you break in guys when they're ready. And that's a strategy, right? And I think that MSU at least conceded, even if it's just for one game, all right, Rocky, you're not working. Let's see what Peyton Thorne can do. Mixed bag, because I think he, completed 50% of his passes as well. It was like 10 for 20 or something. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, showed what he can do with his legs, made a couple big throws, didn't get a lot of help from the rest of his offense. But at least you see that there's something maybe a little bit more to work with. You've seen him now in a real live game experience. And, you know, you've built him at least maybe a little confidence. Didn't really seem like it was very detrimental, considering, you know, he wasn't the one out there making, you know, throwing a ton of interceptions and stuff like that. Did he have one? I don't remember.
He had one bad one. I think it came in the second half, but I mean, like he missed a couple really easy slants and like bad misses, but then he also made some really good – he had a play in the second half. I think he avoided pressure, rolled out to his right, and, like, was running to the sideline and threw a bullet for a 15-yard first down, and everybody was just like, we haven't seen that in years. Yeah. I think – I don't think you can win in college football without a quarterback who can escape pressure. And Rocky, he just stands back there, pocket collapses, and he just goes down with it. And we saw Peyton, you know – jabbing to his right and left. He was avoiding pressure the whole time because the line is Swiss cheese right now. But he showed promise. But honestly, I don't even think that the starting quarterback for next year is on the roster right now. That's just my opinion.
Well, Michigan State needs to modernize the offense. And you can say what you will about Michigan's inability to take advantage of what they have on that light, because they certainly aren't maximizing it. But you know, you have to have a stout defense as well, but you also have to have a modern offense in college football. And I was a little bit leery about, you know, Michigan State kind of not necessarily fully maintaining the status quo, but to some degree maintaining the status quo. And, you know, you just got to be able to go out there and, you know, it doesn't have to necessarily be a spread, but it just has to be more modern than what we saw under Mark D'Antonio. So, For the Spartan side, I mean, hopefully they find a way to get that done, you know, because, yeah, you're going to get a win. You know, I think things are probably, if everything holds, right, and I don't mean this, what's happened this season, but if everything holds roster-wise and just what it is, Michigan State will win one or two out of three or four, you know, every single time around. And against Michigan, that can't just be good enough, right? Like you have to be better if you want to be able to beat Michigan consistently, which I know they did under D'Antonio, but again, things have changed in college football in general. You've got to be able to have a more modern offense to be able to take advantage of some of these things. Watching Iowa has been shocking lately, for instance. Like, they're still Iowa, right? But they have incorporated so many modern elements to their offense, which I almost want to throw bleach into my eyes, because it just seems like so wrong, but yet so right. Just all these jet sweeps and misdirections and things of that nature. So, and I know Mel Tucker's got some of that in there, because I've seen it this year from what limited I've seen Michigan State, but hopefully that continues, you know?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. Well, Isaiah, do you have any last words of wisdom for the Michigan fans that are watching to make sure they don't drink bleach or jump off the Zilwaukee Bridge, something like that?
It's a weird year. We weren't even supposed to have football. They rushed to have football. They didn't even have a full fall camp. People weren't quarantined in the sense of fall. You know, typically fall camp is a month, and they don't have anything to do other than football. By the time they started it and were able to actually do that, they had classes. It's which, by the way, are hard at Michigan. I know that because I failed out initially at Michigan and then went back and barely got my degree. But they're hard, and it's not an easy thing to do. And I understand there's people that are win at all costs, but it's not what Michigan is. So you just have to be patient, understand that the things will, as Brian Cook from MGo Blog says, revert to the mean. Whether that means go up or go down, it will go back up. It just might take a little bit longer than what people think. And that's about pretty much it.
All right, man. Isaiah, thank you so much for being on. We appreciate you. Where can people follow you at on social media?
At Isaiah Hole on all and any platform, or you can catch me at wolverineswire.usatoday.com.
All right. Well, that was Isaiah. We appreciate you, sir. We will hopefully have you back on in the future. And, hey, let's see what happens this week at Rutgers.
All right. Sounds good.
All right. Take care, brother. Welcome back to A Podcast Divided, everyone. We are the line of scrimmage between Michigan and Michigan State fans here on social media. It's time once again for our Pick 10. And I want to introduce to you all who, going forward, our full-time Pick 10 guests, the Iowa's finest, Lucy Rohden. What's good, Lucy? Lucy? Lucy, Lucy. I don't want to say that. I said it. Dang it. I said it.
I forgive you. It's totally fine. I think you have to change the intro because you talk about Michigan, Michigan State. Now you have just this random like Iowa connection in there.
It's all good. Michigan State, Iowa. Hey, it's all good.
Full-time unpaid pick expert.
Well, hey, think about it.
I'll put that on my resume. New LinkedIn bio.
There you go.
One of us was a victor this weekend. It was you. You had an easy.
If it's on Friday, does it really count as a weekend game? Or
I hate playing on Friday.
I know how you felt about that.
I got bullied by a lot of Iowa fans who were like, "Why do you hate Fridays? Like this is great. I love it." And I was like, "I'm gonna calm down."
That's high school. Like, that's a high school football day.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
I agree with that.
I hated it. But
we played outside of this away. And it limits who you can bring to the games for on campus for visits because they're playing. And also you have fans that have to decide, do I go see my kids game or do I come to the, you know, it's just, yeah, dumb. But
it's, anyway, it's because it's been pregame, but that's why.
Yeah. Moving right along, let's go to this week. Our first game, which probably is the game of the week in the big, definitely game of the week in the Big Ten, maybe the country. Indiana at Ohio State. Ladies first, Lucy, who you like?
Oh, I'm taking Ohio State in this one. I like Indiana. I think they're good. I don't think they're that good. And I think, like, Indiana has looked impressive this year, but you look at the teams they beat, you know, Michigan, Michigan State, Penn State, they're not teams that are doing well. I'm not sold on the Hoosiers yet, but I'm always sold on Ohio State, so I'm picking the Buckeyes.
Yeah, I think this one's pretty easy. I mean, Indiana, like she said, Indiana's good. But I wasn't, like, overly impressed with Indiana last week. Michigan State was just terrible, and Ohio State is not Michigan State. So this one might get a little ugly just because Indiana thinks they're way ahead of where they actually are right now.
Yeah. Well, the thing, what they're going to realize quick is Ohio State, and they're probably the second, third best team in the Big Ten right now. But they're going to realize how long of a gulf it is between 2 and 3. And number one, which is Ohio State, they're going to realize it. They realize it fast. I think they're going to lose by at least 21 points. I got Ohio State. It's, until they lose, I really 21. Can't see.
21?
Yeah, big. I think 21 points at least. I think they're going to run away in the end because I don't think they have the means to stop them. I think they'll score some points. I think it'll be – I got 42-21. They'll score, but I don't think they'll be able to, you know, do anything else. But – well, going on to next week, we're going to down to Tallahassee, Florida. Clemson at Florida State. Clemson had the loss against Notre Dame a couple weeks ago, and so they're kind of having to reset and regroup against a Florida State team that's – they're not great, but they're capable of shocking you if you let them hang. Lucy, who you like?
Oh, I mean, Clemson, I think it was maybe a week or two ago, Florida State had like half their team transfer in like the span of like 3 hours. Florida State is not good. Florida State's not good. And I think it's going to be, I mean, it's going to be Clemson, Florida State. It's going to be what we've seen the past couple of years be a blowout.
All right.
Yeah. Every time I see a Florida State update, a score update on Saturday, it's always Florida State down by like 14 points. And that's the ACC is just garbage. So Clemson is just going to wipe the floor with them. I think it's going to be like a 28 point game or something like that.
Yeah. I'm not sure if Clemson's going to be, I mean, Trevor Lawrence is going to be back, but I think just they having the last couple weeks to really stew on what happened with the upset in South Bend, freaking lucky Irish. I think they're going to be able to come down there. I think they're going to beat them, but I think they're going to pound Florida State pretty good. I think Florida State, I think they'll show some energy early, but after a while, they'll just be, you know, same old Clemson. So I have Clemson as well. So we're unanimous in the first two. Let's see if we break. LSU at Arkansas. That's an intriguing one right there. It's a kind of a rivalry game because they border each other geographically. Lucy, who you like to win the game down in Hall Country?
I'm going Woo Pig Suey. I'm picking Arkansas on this one. I know how to do the Woo Pig Suey chant, but I'm not going to do it. You're welcome.
I do too, unfortunately.
It's something. Arkansas got smacked against Florida, gave up 63 points. Yep, that's how you do it. The fingers and everything. I know how to call a hog. I'm not proud of that information, but my mom's from Arkansas. But I'm picking Arkansas in this one. They give up 63 points to Florida. Sam Pittman was out last game, their head coach. I don't know if he's going to be back coaching again this week. LSU didn't play last week. LSU just hasn't looked good this year. Their defense is garbage. I think Arkansas is not going to give up 63 points again. So I'm going the Hogs.
Yeah, I agree. I think Arkansas has this. I've said it every week, I think, that Arkansas is better than people give them credit for. And they were in that Florida game, I think, for like a good two plus, maybe even three quarters. Whoever LSU runs out there at quarterback is not going to be as good as Kyle Trask. And I don't think, like she said, they're not going to give up 63 again. I think Arkansas wins this one by like a touchdown.
Yeah, same here. LSU, they're kind of having an identity crisis. They lost a lot from that juggernaut they had last year. I just don't think they're the same team playing on the road. Limited crowd in Fayetteville. I think it's in Fayetteville or Little Rock. I'm not sure which one we're doing this time. But yes, Arkansas. I think the Razorbacks are gonna be able to limit them, and I think they'll score enough points. Give me Arkansas, Felipe Franks, baby. And moves us on to our next one. You know, our next game is, we're going to come back to familiar territory. Very intriguing game.
It's a big
Wisconsin
one.
Wisconsin at Northwestern. What you think, Lucy?
Oh, I'm going Wisconsin in this one. Granted, Northwestern looks better this year than they did last year. They're undefeated, whatever. I know we've only seen Wisconsin in two games, but in those two games, I have just been so sad that Iowa has to play Wisconsin. They are very good. Graham Mertz isn't, you know, Superman like we thought he was, but I can't bet against Wisconsin. I think they'll win this game. But I do think Northwestern should, I've said this, fake COVID, cancel the game so that Wisconsin doesn't get their six wins. At that point, Northwestern wins the Big Ten West. I don't know why they haven't done this yet. It's so easy. That's what I would do. You're welcome, Northwestern. You're welcome.
They're supposed to be the smart ones, and you're giving them strategies. I like
exactly.
that.
Exactly.
This is interesting because I think Northwestern is way better than they were last year, obviously, but it's at Northwestern. One thing about Northwestern that everybody in the Big Ten knows is any game at Northwestern is never really a home game for Northwestern.
Never.
There's probably going to be more. Well, if there were fans in attendance, there would be more Wisconsin fans than Northwestern fans. The atmosphere just doesn't scare anybody away. I think Wisconsin and Graham Mertz are just going to be too much. She said Graham Mertz isn't the Superman like everybody thinks. I think Graham Mertz is going to have a huge game. He's probably going to put up 300 yards for the first time in his career.
The reason why he wasn't Superman, because Clark Kent was enough to beat Michigan. That's the reason why he wasn't Superman. Yeah. That's the reason why. He's gonna pull the S out of his chest, because he's going to need to, because Northwestern's a very hard-nosed team. Peyton Ramsey, fifth-year senior transfer from Indiana, is playing well. I think Northwestern is going to play tough. I think it's going to be a close game that's going to come down with the fourth quarter. I think Wisconsin has enough firepower to get out of there. So, hey, we're 3-for-3. Wisconsin, once again.
And she had Northwestern, right? You had Northwestern?
No, I picked Wisconsin. Ew. I'm not picking Northwestern. Gross.
No, of course not. Nobody.
Wait, time out. Random thought in the middle of the picks. Have you guys ever heard their first down chant or the third down chant at Northwestern? Have you ever gone to a game?
Never
heard. Like the cat. It's like,
no, they do that after every play. Every play. It is bad. The worst. They do the cat growl, and then Iowa State does a storm siren.
That's very annoying.
And you can't, I feel like you can't do that in Iowa where we have like actual storm stuff, but those are my, like, I hate those. Yeah. Going to Ryan Field's the worst. My least
Northwestern has one of the most annoying. Yeah.
Speaking of Iowa State. Let's take a trip to Ames, Iowa, your favorite place in the world, Lucy, Kansas State at Iowa State.
Well, they don't let me back in Ames after I pulled a prank there, and now I'm not welcome. Let's see. I'm actually picking Kansas State in this one. I know I think Iowa State is better, but I feel like Iowa State always falls into this trap game against Kansas State. Feels like this is a yearly thing for them. Kansas State, they have weird quarterback issues and they have COVID issues, but for some reason, Iowa State's playing Texas the next week. So I think the Clones are going to overlook Kansas State. So I'm actually picking the Wildcats in this one, and I'm really happy to do that. I want to see Iowa State lose. I really do.
Well, of course.
Let me bring you back down to earth a little bit. I think Iowa State's going to win this one, and I think it's going to be like a 14-point win. They don't even need Brock Purdy, even though I think Purdy's had like a bad year, and I think that he's actually get like one of the better quarterbacks in the country, but he's just playing – for some reason, he's just playing terribly. They don't even need him, though, because they got Breece Hall, who's leading the country in rushing.
He is
very good. I think he'll probably put up like 200 yards and they'll win by two touchdowns.
Yep. Brock Purdy is a Purdy man. Iowa State by 10. I'm sorry, Lucy.
That's fine. Whatever. We don't have to be friends. I didn't want to be friends in the first place.
Gotta go with the
kidding.
Gotta go with the magic of Ames, Iowa.
There is no magic in Ames, Iowa. If you've ever been to
basketball,
there
is.
Hilton Magic, man.
Yeah, last time we went to Hilton Magic, there was no magic at all. Iowa beat the crap out of them. And then Jordan Bohannon signed his shoes and left them on the court. That's the magic of Hilton. It was the coolest thing ever. It was so cool.
And there's some vitriol for those
people. I don't like them. They don't like me. Like, they really don't like me.
Okay, so this is now a Nebraska slander. And an Iowa State slander.
I won't
podcast.
I don't have hatred for Iowa State yet.
I don't either. They're
just
they're
give
okay
it time. Just give it time.
I know people who went to Iowa State.
Let's go down south.
My uncle went to Iowa State.
Get a team where we can all kind of neutral about Oklahoma State at Oklahoma. Bedlam.
I kind of struggled with this pick. I'm going Oklahoma State. Granted, both of these teams really don't have anything to lose at this point. Oklahoma State kind of screwed that by losing to Texas. But I don't trust Radler, the quarterback for Oklahoma. I don't trust him yet. So I'm going Oklahoma State, but it's kind of a toss-up for me.
Yeah.
It is a tough one. I think Oklahoma is playing, some of the best football in the country, though. And Oklahoma State, they just had that heartbreaking loss. I think it was to Texas a couple weeks ago.
Mm-hmm. Texas, yeah.
And I just – I like Rattler. I think that he has made a lot of mistakes this year that's gotten him in trouble early, and that's probably why they won't make the playoff. But I think that he pulls off enough plays, even though Oklahoma State has one of the best defenses in the Big 12. I think Oklahoma wins a really close one, maybe last second field goal. Hot take, bold prediction, last second field goal.
Yeah. Bedlam is just that. It's Bedlam. One thing about it is Oklahoma State always plays Oklahoma tough, especially in one of these, especially in Norman. So I think that Mike Riley, the mullet, I think they're going to make enough plays. And I think they're going to pull the upset off. Two point win, field goal. I got the Pokes, Oklahoma State.
He's a man. He's 40.
Yeah, I think he's 53 now, but yeah, that's when he was 40. But yeah. Well, finally, we're finally landed on the teams that we love and hate the most.
Nope. You got one more?
No. Before that.
We have to worry about the dumb Pac-12, I guess.
Yeah, US. Okay, let's make this quick because I don't really care. I'm going to play it. US,
I get it.
USC at Utah. Who you got, Lucy?
I'm picking USC. Has Utah even played a game yet? I don't think they have. Yeah. So I'm picking USC, even though USC's offense looks super funky. I'm picking the Trojans.
I mean, I'll just go against you for no reason other than I'm going to go against you. I'm going to go with Utah just because USC is such a fraud and Clay Helton's going to lose his job. So I'm going to go Utah.
All fair.
USC has been cheating death the last 2 weeks. They should have lost to both the Arizona teams, but they found a way. Their running game stinks, but they do have a prolific passing game. I pick USC simply because of the no fans, because Utah has a tough – Salt Lake City with the altitude is a tough place to play. I pick also as well they've been playing, and they're battle-tested. They're confident. To some extent. So I'm riding with the Fighting Clay Heltons and the Trojans. Fight on. I'm going to go with the Trojans. So now we've made it to the teams that we love and hate the most. Let's start with Lucy's game. Iowa at the winless Penn State Nittany Lions. What you think?
The last time Iowa beat Penn State, I was in sixth grade. It was a long time ago. I am picking Iowa in this game but I am a little nervous. And I know you're like, God, Penn State's so bad. You shouldn't be nervous. But for some reason, we haven't beat Penn State in 11 years. We just can't seem to beat that program. And it's usually pretty close. I'm picking Iowa in this one because Penn State is just terrible. They're literally so bad. So go Hawks. I'm picking Iowa.
I think you said that you always pick Iowa.
Yep.
So, okay. So
except for against Wisconsin, I won't pick Iowa then.
I don't feel bad picking Penn State here. I think Iowa's the better team, but I think just because I say this every week, I said this when they were 0-1, I said that when they were 0-2, I said when they're 0-3, I can't see them going 0-5 to start the season. I mean, they were a top 10 team. I don't know. They seem to have figured out the quarterback situation with the Levis or whatever his name is.
Franklin said today he hasn't named a starter yet.
I mean, that's coach speak. I mean, I guess you got to let him battle it out during practice, but Clifford's probably not starting, but I think that Penn State, it's going to be like a 13.
You want to pick Iowa.
I do want to pick Iowa, but I just can't see Penn State going 0-5. I just can't see it. I don't know. Maybe I'm going to go Penn State though. I feel so bad about that pick.
You should feel bad about that.
I don't feel good about it.
The thing about it is Happy Valley is not a happy place right now. And you're in the middle of nowhere playing in a gigantic, you know, Lego built stadium with no fans. Iowa's playing confident. They had a really good game against Minnesota last week. Penn State is still finding themselves. I think Penn State's going to play hard. But right now, I think Iowa's the better team. Penn State's going to go 0-5. I pick plotting Lucy Rohdens and the Iowa Hawkeyes.
Make me look dumb.
We will.
It doesn't take much effort, man.
I mean, to be fair, I did say that Michigan State was a lock to beat Indiana last week, and I was wrong.
A lock.
I had such a good feeling.
You used the L word?
No, I didn't use that word, but I said I was saying it for a whole week. I was like, Michigan State's going to win, and I'm not even going to be surprised because the season makes no sense. And you know what? You know what they did? They went out and lost 24-0.
No way.
I was close. They tied the second half.
Michigan State, they traveled to the oldest campus, the oldest looking campus I've ever been on. I was there last year to watch Michigan and Maryland play. Oh, like looks like George Washington just built the whole campus, every building.
Smells of rich mahogany.
Yes, like one of those little funny bucket hats they used to wear during the Declaration of Independence. Like I felt like I was underdressed because I wasn't wearing one of those hats. That's how old the campus is. But Michigan State at Maryland. Maryland's got one of the Tagovailoa brothers on the road. They're starting to play a little bit better. Of course, they had the cancellation last week against Ohio State, so they've had a week off. Michigan State's still trying to find themselves. Peyton don't make it the start. They may run the number 12 out there. Who knows? But, Lucy, who you got in that game?
I've got Maryland, but I have it a little bit closer than I originally expected. Sorry, Connor, but you picked Penn State. So
I deserve this.
You just can't trust Michigan State right now. And I'm happy to see they're making quarterback changes because they really need to do that. You know, I'm the best Iowan in the Michigan State community. Sorry, Rocky Lombardi, you got to move over. He's just so bad. But yeah, I just don't trust Michigan State right now. But I think it'll be a little bit closer than people think. But Maryland's kind of rolling. The only thing that worries me about that game is that, you know, Maryland didn't play last week.
I'm a little less confident in my Michigan State pick this week because I was way off base last week. I don't think I've only picked one Michigan State game right this year, and it was the Iowa loss. This might be their last opportunity to actually win a game, like the real opportunity. But Tua's little brother is playing like out of his mind right now.
Yeah.
Ever since that 40-point loss against Northwestern, which still doesn't make sense to me. I mean, he's been lights out, and you know, just because I'm going to be different, I'm going to go Michigan State, even though, you know, if Rocky starts, I throw that prediction right out the window. But if Rocky does not start, Michigan State's winning.
It's way back. It's a homer. Look at the homer.
Hey, I picked Michigan State to lose to Iowa a couple weeks ago, and I was not playing one of the only ones.
You were so right on that, Connor.
I was so right. It only took one quarter for that to be correct.
Yeah. So proud of you.
Well, this game is going to be interesting. I just don't see Michigan State scoring enough points, just to be just objectively speaking. I just don't see them throwing enough points in this game. If Tua's little brother, I think it's Talia Tagovailoa, if he can put about 14 to 17 points up in the first half, I just don't see Michigan State matching that. I think it'll be a 2-touchdown win for Maryland. So I'm taking the fighting Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
The 7 points scored over the last 8 quarters has not impressed you. Is that what you're saying?
I feel averaging less than one point a quarter. Yeah. Not quite.
Not good. Oh, okay.
More than zero points.
I think that's normal now. I'm so used to that. That's like Michigan State football.
Well, for our finale, we got
the JV team in the state.
Michigan playing on the road in Piscataway, New Jersey at Rutgers. I guess an improved Rutgers team. It's a prime time game on Big Ten Network. Woo!
Prime time.
Who you got, Lucy? What you think?
I actually struggled with this pick a lot because logic says that Rutgers beat Michigan State and Michigan State beat Michigan. And that, so by the transitive property, Rutgers wins. I just think with the way that Michigan just got whomped by Wisconsin, I think they'll bounce back against Rutgers. You know, Rutgers lost against Illinois last week, and that's brutal. I want Rutgers to win. I'm sorry, Don. I do. I just think Rutgers being back is awesome. And that is just, it directly correlates to my happiness is Rutgers winning for some reason. But I'm going Michigan in this one. But I want it to be Rutgers. I just want to put that out there.
You and me both. I would love nothing more than to watch Michigan lose to Rutgers just so I can go back and find all the receipts
of course,
Michigan fans who were bashing Michigan State for losing to Rutgers.
We ain't got nothing to say now anyways, man.
I mean, that's true. The whole Michigan State win wiped that out, but this would just be like a cherry on top. Like, this would just be
– I don't like
– like, we're bad. We're so bad. Never before has a team started possibly 1-4 and had so much ammo to talk trash to their rival, and it makes me so happy. I don't know. It's such a good year. With that being said, I don't think Rutgers is going to keep up. I think Michigan's going to play angry. They'll probably end up running up the score like they always do on Rutgers. Rutgers is a better team this year, but I mean, they'll score more, but they'll still get scored on quite a bit. It's going to be like a 3-touchdown game.
Yeah. I think it's definitely a must win just for the psyche. Of course, the Big Ten championship and is all out the window now, but I think Michigan needs something. Just a tad. Yeah. Michigan right now feels really bad about themselves, and they need something to feel good. And I think this game is a game where I think they can get some confidence back. Because Michigan is not as poorly talented as their 1-3 record suggests. They're not in the way they played. It's just with a young team, you rise and fall based on what you do. I think Michigan was high, even though Minnesota's not very good, Michigan was high flying and during that game because they think good things were happening. And I think the Michigan State game kind of broke them with the way that they lost. And I think they need something good to happen. I think they'll get that good thing happen this weekend. I don't think it'll be – I think they'll beat them by 7 points. I don't think it'll be a blowout. But I think a happy flight home and a positive going the football facility on Sunday and Monday, just feeling good about yourself, that's what they need. So I think – I'm long-winded, but I think Michigan's going to win this game.
Nothing revitalizes a program more than a Rutgers win.
Just a win. I don't care if we were playing Mary Harden Baylor, Division III school in Texas. I don't care, man. Let's just get the win. Let's feel good about ourselves and like get that. This done. That's how I feel. I think Michigan just needs something good to happen. And hopefully it snowballs into something else, and who knows. But yeah, so that's our Pick 10. What y'all think? Add it in the comments and everything. But yeah, those are our picks. And let's see how we do. Hopefully, I take the
lead. I've never felt worse about a pick 10 in my life. I don't think I'm going to get any right. I honestly don't think I'm going to get a single one.
Like, I've half never of ours are worse. The same.
Yeah. I mean, I don't think any of us are going to do very well.
Yeah, we'll see.
I'm
we'll
fine
see.
With that.
Yeah. Well, that is our pick 10. We'll see what happens. We'll come back next week and talk about how we did. You are once again watching a podcast. Divide it. He be right back. Right back. Oh, man. Dude, Lucy's a trip, dude. Welcome back. This is a podcast divided.
It's wild.
She's a trip, man. This is a fun show, man. She, man. Great addition. But yeah.
Full time unpaid. Just what she wanted.
Yeah, none of us are paid. Sure, we're paying to have this thing, but that's for now. Hopefully for later, now. Some sponsors will think like us enough and pay us, and then we can treat ourselves to some Chick-fil-A, as Moose was talking about. Yes. Well, anyways, we thank y'all for joining in. Michigan State travels to Maryland. Michigan goes to Rutgers. Two teams in bad need for wins on the road on the East Coast. So hopefully they can get that done this weekend and we can be happy, but no matter what, we're talking basketball.
Fingers crossed that COVID doesn't, postpone any of these or cancel any of these, yes. Which Michigan State very may well be postponed or canceled. But yes, if that happens, I mean, just more reason to look forward to basketball. More reason.
It's almost basketball season. That's what we're holding on to. But we
happy faces because of that.
Yes. We thank you all so much for tuning in to A Podcast Divided. This is our house. But y'all welcome anytime. I'm Don Thomas. It's Connor Muldowney. We are signing off. We will see y'all next week. We'll talk a little football, but we'll talk more basketball.
Go green.
Go blue.